Hi there, it's Graham.
And Victoria.
Reviewing Big Fish. This film is directed by Tim Burton and stars Ewan McGregor, Albert Finney, and Billy Caltrop.
This film, released in 2003, is considered a fantasy drama with hints of Southern Gothic themes and is based on the novel of the same name by Daniel Wallace. The film was given a budget of $70 million and it earned $122 million plus in the box office.
The plot is driven by two forces, both a fantastical, larger-than-life story of Edward Bloom, a natural-born storyteller, as well as his son's drive to learn the truth behind the tall tales he'd always heard before the older Bloom dies.
I just get so hungry. I'm just too big.
Did you ever think that maybe you're not too big?
But maybe this town is just too small? Now, I've heard in real cities they've got buildings so tall you can't even see the tops of them.
Really?
I wouldn't lie to you. And all-you-can-eat buffets? Now, you can eat a lot, can't you?
I can.
So why are you wasting your time in a small town? You're a big man. You should be in a big city.
You're just trying to get me to leave, aren't you?
What's your name, Giant?
Carl.
Well, mine's Edward. And truthfully, well, I do want you to leave, Carl. But I want to leave with you. I mean, you think this town is too small for you? Well, it's too small for a man of my ambition. So what do you say? Join me?
Okay.
The storyline of Big Fish is really divided into two that slowly converge on the same ending as Edward Bloom's life is coming to a close. The majority of the movie is the story of Edward Bloom's life as he's always told it, full of exaggerations and tall tales that portray him as a wonderful man who's had a wonderful life. These tales are packed with entertaining details and witty lines that make the audience laugh out loud, but at the same time wish that his story was reality. Tim Burton puts his imagination into these tales, bringing the fantasy world of Edward Bloom's Alabama to life in a way that excites both audiences old and young.
It occurred to me then that perhaps the reason for my growth was that I was intended for larger things. After all, a giant man can't have an ordinary-sized life. And as soon as my bones had settled in their adult configuration, I set upon my plan to make a bigger place for myself in Ashton.
While the tall tales add a family-oriented quality to the film, the drama portion is also worth mentioning. Unlike many dramas, this father-son story feels real, giving a realistic glimpse both at the falling out between the older and younger Blooms, as well as the way in which they reconcile. Surprisingly, Burton does not overdo the emotions here, but rather presents the pair in a way that makes them relatable. Furthermore, Burton wove the tall tales within this frame very well, having both characters give their stories, allowing the audience to hear the internal voices of both Blooms.
I was hoping we could talk about some things while I'm here.
You mean while I'm here?
I just want to know the true versions of things, events, stories.
Within this film, the acting was critical, especially as these tall tales were, in a sense, Edward Bloom's reality. Therefore, the actors had to both portray a sense of being larger than life while remaining somewhat realistically human.
Ewan McGregor played the energetic and infallible younger Edward spot on. He keeps an optimistic attitude that makes the audience believe that nothing is ever wrong. It is also worth mentioning that his southern accent was perfect. Albert Finney portrayed the dying father that was older Edward astoundingly. When he's introduced on his deathbed, you can almost smell the nursing home environment as he coughs and asks for water.
More impressive to me were the supporting actors. Helena Bonham was marvelous as always, managing to stand as both wise and creepy within her role as the witch, despite the audience not once hearing her speak. She also did wonderfully as the older Jenny, creating a believable crush as well as bridging the gap between those two roles. Danny DeVito is also worth mentioning for his role as Amos, the ringleader and werewolf. from whom Edward learns of his wife. In short, despite their limited airtime, I believe that the supporting cast just might have stolen the show.
One criticism I have about the acting is how McGregor and Finney didn't really mix well. Both actors were phenomenal in their roles, but it was hard to believe at times that they were the same person. That might have been a conscious choice on the director's part, to make the exaggerations of the tall tales less believable to those that were close to the real Edward. But it was a little confusing at times. I also have to complain a little bit about the lack of emotion in Billy Caltrop's portrayal of William Bloom. The character is at a critical point in his life, where he is about to lose his father, and he is about to become a father himself within a month. I feel like Caltrop played the father-son drama well, but the rest of the time, the emotions of someone in his position just didn't seem there.
My only complaint would be for the Spectre scene. All the actors portrayed a sense of creepiness within their too-happy town, which led me to believe there would be more to that storyline. However, the film didn't deliver, which led me to believe that perhaps something got cut, or maybe the actors simply aren't believable in their portrayal of happiness. While this film is said to be a fantasy drama, it is not quite as fantastical as one might imagine, but rather, it is probably the most realistic Tim Burton film I've seen in terms of film color, sound, and effects. Even when Burton does fantastic things through behind-the-camera magic, such as when he has the car underwater or has time stop and then speed back up, it is rather understated, missing the surreal vividness we often see with Burton. The mise-en-scene and costumes are also not as over-the-top as one might expect, even when the stories become somewhat crazy. The only times that the costumes become truly flamboyant are during the circus scenes, not even truly then, as well as the Siamese twins' outfits. This is both a plus and a minus. For those who love Burton's more artistic flair, the film will flop. But for those who are interested in filming that focuses on the story, this is the best of Burton.
The two use different film techniques to emphasize the drastic change in mood between the stories and reality. The scenes in reality use close-up shots to capture the emotions on the characters' faces and fluffs up the drama, while the tall tales are more zoomed out to capture the fantastic things going on around him. The reality scenes are also darker than the tall tales, which are vibrantly colored, as if to show how dull the truth really is for Edward Bloom. How the plot of this movie is told is not your standard straightforward story. Both the sub-stories are told chronologically, but the tall tales are set in the frame of Bloom's reality, each giving a different tone to the way the tales are told and what degree of how believable they are. Throughout the film, we encounter several themes and motifs. From Edward Bloom's story, we understand the need to become larger than life, seen with his recurring comments of being too large for his small town, given his great ambition. Similarly, his stories show the way in which truth is relative, for the older Bloom clearly feels that his stories are a more accurate portrayal of himself than his current condition.
It is that version of the truth that causes the rift with his son, for William feels that these stories are not the truth, but rather a farce for his father to hide behind. The viewer is left to decide which version of reality he wishes to subscribe to.
And that's the real story of how you were born. Not very exciting, is it? And I suppose if I had to choose between the true version and an elaborate one involving a fish and a wedding ring, I might choose the fancy version. But then that's just me.
I kind of liked your version.
Still, while William might be resentful of his father's stories, we said that the two are more alike than they might think. After all, while Edward has spent his entire life weaving tales, William has now made a career of it, being a journalist. However, the one indisputable fact is that there is a rift between the two, and the story follows the way in which the two Blooms set out to understand each other and hopefully reconcile before Edward dies. In short, this film is a feel-good family fantasy drama filled with adventure, heartbreak, and comedy. We strongly recommend this film, especially to Tim Burton fans.
This has been Graham.
And Victoria.
Now stop watching us and go pick up Big Fish.